I want to share with you a quick testimony of something that began in the winter of 2018. Early in the year, in January, a man sent me a book. The title of the book was The World on Fire, and it was written by Rick Joyner. This book is an account of the Welsh Revival. I don't read many books outside of Scripture, so I was hesitant to pick this one up. It sat on my coffee table throughout the week, and then as I got home from work on Friday evening, I picked it up after dinner and began to read. I was soon gripped by the Spirit of the Lord resting upon this book. I read late into the night, up till 1 or 2 o'clock in the morning, and then went to bed out of exhaustion. I woke up early the next morning before anyone else and could not wait to get back into this book. As I read, its pages came alive. As I read, I could feel the souls of the people that were in the Welsh Revival and the experiences of the glory of God that they had. I found myself returning to work on Monday, grabbing the book on the way out the door and taking it to work with me. Every opportunity I got, I would run out to my car and I would read a paragraph or a page or a chapter in the book and go back into work. And while working, I would meditate on the things that I had just read. I was consumed with this book and gripped by the Holy Spirit about the Welsh Revival. As you read this book, you will see that the Welsh Revival holds a pattern that no revival ever showed, even since the day of Pentecost. And I believe that this pattern represents what God is about to do in these last days. One of the greatest attributes of the Welsh Revival was that it was allowed to be controlled by the Holy Spirit. The secret of the Welsh Revival was that man sat down and God stood up. The Holy Spirit was allowed to minister as He chose. Many ministers who would come from around the world to visit the Welsh Revival would be disturbed by what they experienced in the meetings. If the meeting was scheduled to start at 7 o'clock that evening, the sanctuary would be packed out to capacity, the doors left open, the windows left open, and people would be on the lawn because there were more people than the building could hold. At 7 o'clock, the service was supposed to start, but no one would get up to welcome visitors and guests. No one began to sing, no one began to pray, but in the majority of the meetings, the people just sat and waited upon the Lord. Sometimes they would wait 30 minutes, 45 minutes, an hour or more. And then suddenly, prompted purely by the Spirit of God, someone would stand up and read a scripture, and the glory of the Lord would fill the sanctuary. Or they would stand up and begin to sing a song. And soon the congregation would join with them. No piano, no guitars, just voices singing in adoration of the Lamb. And sometimes they would sing the same song over and over and over for hours on end. But every few minutes during the singing, someone would stand and cry out loud, "Oh God, save me." And they would be born again. Or someone would jump to their feet and yell, "I'm healed. I'm healed by the power of God." And this would go on for hours. Ministers would come from all over the world and think that the waiting upon the Lord and God using young people, most in their teens, to preach the gospel when it was preached, to pray the prayers of intercession that would see multitudes come into the kingdom. Great ministers from all over the world were bothered by this. And some of them would attempt to walk up to the pulpit to initiate what they thought should be happening. But it never failed. The fear of the Lord would grip these ministers in such depth that they would back away from the pulpit as if not turning their back on a lion. the Welsh revival was powerful. On February 17th of 2018, after about 5 weeks of reading The World on Fire and meditating upon it and being gripped by it, weeping with it, I called the publisher and I requested I would like to order a case of these books, because if it's gripped me this much, I want to purchase more of these books and hand them out to friends and acquaintances and my congregation. They put me through to the department where I could order in bulk an entire case. No one answered the phone, so I left a message. That was on Monday, February 17th, and I waited the rest of the day and no call was returned. I waited all day Tuesday. I got no return call. Again on Wednesday, I called the publisher and I said, I would like to order a case of The World on Fire. They put me through to the department that would help me. Again, no one answered the phone. So I left another message. Please give me a call. I would like to order a case of these books. I waited throughout the day on Wednesday. No one returned my call. I waited Thursday. No one returned my call. And then Friday morning, I received a call. A young lady called me and she said, hi, I got your message and I'm sorry for the delay. How can I help you? I said, I would like to order a case of these books. She replied, okay, they come 60 to a case and they're $15 each. Wow, I was surprised. That was way above my budget. And I let her know politely, that's okay, I'm sorry to bother you, but that's way above my budget. I said, I'm going to take the one book that I have, put my name in it, and pass it around to my friends and congregation. We hung up the phone. Later that afternoon, she called me back. She asked me, she said, sir, do you mind me asking, what is your budget for buying these books? And I said, well, I have $100, and I might could pay a little extra for tax or shipping. She said, well, I spoke with the head of my department and he has agreed to give you the books at $5 each, however many you can afford. So I was excited. So she said, okay, here's what I can do. I want to give you the most books possible and try to stay close to your $100 budget. She said, with shipping and with tax, I can send you for about $120, $125. I can send you 22 books. So I was really excited. So I said, okay. So I gave her my credit card number over the phone, and sure enough, she sent me the book. After I hung up the phone with her, I realized that she had called me and told me the offer at 2:22 that afternoon. As I saw that 2:22, at first I thought it was the date because it was February 22nd. But it was 2:22 in the afternoon on February 22nd, 2:22, and I took this as a sign that the Lord was showing me that He was divinely ordering my steps concerning that book. So that afternoon, I went back to work for a few more hours and would work hard to get more time to come out to the car and read the book some more. And then I was working out of town that day, about 45 minutes from home, and I got off work about 5 o'clock and started home. Well, to get to my house, I have to come up the mountain. Where I was working that day is at about 1,200 feet elevation, and where I live is about 3,500 feet elevation. So as I'm coming home, I'm driving up the mountain and I get behind a vehicle with North Carolina license plates, but it's personalized plates. And the personalized plate has W-A-L-E-S, Wales. So here I've been reading for 5-6 weeks this book about the Welsh revival. And here at 2:22 in the afternoon that day on February 22nd, 2:22, I get behind a vehicle with the license plate Wales. Immediately the Holy Spirit came upon me And he said, everything that you're reading about in that book, I will bring up this mountain. That day I was so broken by the Lord, I had to pull off the highway. I so longed to see the glory of the Lord come to these mountains and come to this nation. Friend, our nation has to experience the glory of God. We're not going to be rescued by a vote. We're not going to be rescued by popular opinion. Only the glory of God is going to rescue and save the church, the body of Christ. Only the glory of God is going to rescue and save our families. Only the glory of God is going to rescue and save our communities, our towns, our cities, and our nation. Only the glory of God will bring glory to the Lamb. So I challenge you and I ask you, please, this day, seek His face. As the scripture says, the glory of God is in the face of Jesus. As you listen to me narrate this book, I ask you, please, humble yourself and ask the Lord, please move in my heart to cry out for a move of God to come to our nation. And Lord, not just so that we can idolize a move of God, not so we can idolize a revival, but so we can lift up the Lamb and see the purity of the covenant that He has made with us by the will of His Father, by the power of His Spirit, by the truth of His Word. I love you, friend. I hope and pray that you will allow the Holy Spirit to move upon you as He longs to. Thank you. The World on Fire, Introduction. This book is a three-part study of what was almost certainly, for the short period of time that it lasted, the world's greatest revival, the Welsh Revival. There is no other example in either biblical or church history in which a region was so quickly or radically transformed for righteousness, or the world so impacted, as happened during this revival. The fire of this move of God was so intense that when letters or newspaper stories about the revival were read in other parts of the world, revival would break out there. Today, over a century after it happened, those who read or hear the story are still impacted with both profound conviction and hope. The inevitable question for us is this: will God do it again? The answer, yes. That is the purpose of this study. It is exciting and inspiring to hear about the great things that God has done. But the purpose for the excitement and the inspiration is so that He, God, can do it again, but with us. The scriptures declare that the greatest move of God of all time will occur at the end of this age. The Welsh revival, as great as it was, is but a foretaste of something much greater that is coming. One of the most important questions that any believer, any church, any ministry can ask today is how to get ready for the great harvest that is at the end of this age. With the exception of the advent of Christ, this harvest unquestionably will be the greatest event in the history of the world. The greatest proportion of Bible prophecy focuses on this period, and the significant events in church history are in preparation for it. The church is not here to be an observer. We are here to light the world on fire. The fire that is about to be lit will burn until every bit of wood, hay, and stubble is consumed, and the gold, silver, and precious stones are purified. Prophetic parallels found in the history of the Welsh Revival can help to guide us in the necessary preparation for these times. The church and the community of Wales were remarkable parallels of the church today and the condition of society. We can see in this history an accurate map that can show us where we have been, where we are now, and where we are going. Understanding how the spiritual foundation was laid for this great revival can help us to understand the foundation that the Lord is laying today in His church to prepare for this harvest. Understanding what was done correctly can help us to do things right. Likewise, honestly looking at the mistakes can help us to avoid making the same ones. As a wise man once stated, those who do not know history are doomed to repeat it. There are many aspects of this great revival that we want to repeat, and many that we want to avoid. The foundation of the contemporary church contains potential for both the coming revival and the similar catastrophic mistakes. It seems that the great interest that is now being stirred in the church to study history is the grace of God to help us to do it right this time. Let us not neglect so great a grace. The World on Fire, Chapter 2. The plan was not to plan. Broken plans seemed to be the hallmark of the Welsh Revival. Just weeks before it broke out in his home church in Lofoten, Evan had planned campaigns throughout Wales with his brother Dan and a friend named Sidney Evans. Quickly, he discovered that the spirit had another plan, and his plans were much better. Evan soon developed a healthy fear of man's planning and organization in the midst of revival. This is not to imply that leadership and organization are not at times needed in the church, but when the Spirit is doing something new and fresh, the greatest gift is not knowing how to lead, but knowing how to follow. The attempts at organization during the Welsh Revival all proved futile and at times a hindrance to the true work. It seems that every time the Spirit wants to move in a creative way, He still has to find those who are formless and void. Those with the humility that comes from knowing they do not have the answers, which stimulates a holy desperation for God in them, these seem to be the only ones who can ever be responsive to the Lord when He wants to do a new thing. Evan Roberts refused to follow his meetings or visits to a city to be announced until a day or two before he was to arrive. Even then, he would only say that he hoped to be at a certain place at a certain time. As the Lord Jesus explained to Nicodemus, "The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear the sound of it, but do not know where it comes from or where it is going. So is everyone who is born of the Spirit." The workers in the Welsh Revival came to understand that the Lord meant this literally. Finally, they did not try to figure out where the Spirit was going next. They only tried to stay close enough to hear the sound of it. The workers came to abhor the presumption that the Spirit would automatically go with them and bless their own plans. They knew that the Spirit did not follow them, but that they must follow the Spirit. It is noteworthy that many who have tried to duplicate this kind of ministry style succumbed to spiritual delusions or have even suffered the shipwreck of their faith. Even the apostles to the early church often planned their missionary journeys and would announce their impending visits months ahead of time. Yet they always remained open for the Lord to change their plans. Nevertheless, the apostles could not always keep their intentions to visit a city, as with Paul's attempts to revisit the Corinthians. The point is that our renewed minds are not in conflict with the Holy Spirit. The Lord did not lead the apostles around by the hand. He sent them. They made many of their own decisions because they had His mind, but because they were always growing and maturing, they did not always make the right decisions. At times, the Lord would correct their course with an intervention of divine guidance through a dream, a vision, or a prophet. We must labor with the spiritual wisdom that has been given to us, but always be open for the Lord to intervene and change our plans. During times of a dynamic outpouring of the Holy Spirit, such as the Welsh Revival, the Lord can only use those who will yield themselves completely to Him in order that He might do something entirely new. It seems that in every city the Apostle Paul visited, the Holy Spirit moved differently than in the previous ones. Paul moved with vision, strategy, and decisiveness, but with a finely tuned sensitivity to the Holy Spirit and the willingness to yield to a different plan. Many of the great missionary ventures in church history, such as William Booth's Salvation Army, they were planned over many years, and they generally followed the plan. Those who might have worked with some of these missionary ventures would probably scorn the lack of organization of the Welsh Revival. Likewise, those who were a part of the Welsh Revival would almost certainly reject the seeming over-dependence on organization that such missionary societies had. A great tribute to General Booth was that he visited the Welsh Revival, observed that it was functioning in almost the opposite manner in which he ran the Salvation Army, and was still able to recognize that it was God and should not be tampered with. He then went back and continued to run the army just the way he had been, recognizing that God employs different strategies for different places or different purposes. We must realize that the God who makes every snowflake different seldom moves the same way twice. It is His nature to be creative and diverse. There are lessons for the whole church in the way the Lord moved in Wales. Likewise, there are lessons for us all in the way that He moved through the Salvation Army in its early years. The Welsh Revival actually died because it took the fear of organization and fear of human intervention too far. Likewise, the Salvation Army, though still a large organization and doing many good works, is spiritually only a shell of its former glory because the organization was not flexible enough to hold new wine. Seek the wine, not the wineskin. Those who have tried to duplicate the original glory of the Salvation Army have, for the most part, failed. Those who have tried to duplicate the Welsh Revival have often become pitiful caricatures of the original revivalists. There does not seem to be a single example in church history where a wineskin of church organization was built before the new wine of revival was given. This does not necessarily mean that it cannot be done, just that it has not yet been done, and does seem to be most improbable. Those who have tried to build the wineskin first have often found themselves out of step and unable to receive the new wine when it came. The Lord has never restricted Himself to move by any predetermined formula. There is one quality common in those who have been mightily used by the Holy Spirit. They were able to hear the sound of the Holy Spirit moving and were willing to move the way that He wanted for that time and place. The lessons of this great revival are critically important for the last day church to understand, because she will see the greatest harvest of all. As the Lord Jesus testified, the harvest is the end of the age. The important lessons of the Welsh Revival must be combined with the knowledge of many different ways that the Lord has chosen to move in other places and at other times if they are to be properly understood. All of this knowledge must be received with the humility to comprehend that we cannot know or understand all that can be known or understood about the way God moves. We must remain open for Him to act in ways that we do not understand or have not heard of before. Evan Roberts greatly feared man's planning and organization, and that made him a fit vessel for what the Lord wanted to do in Wales in 1904. When the campaign was finally organized for his visit to Liverpool, it was a good example of Evan's uncompromising commitment to walk in the way that he understood. The committee pressed him to state a definite time when he would come. He refused to do it. When he did eventually go, he gave the committee only 4 days' warning that he was coming. Even then, though 100,000 Welsh people in that English city were longing and waiting to hear him, he insisted that he could not know in which of the crowded chapels he would speak at a given time. Dan Roberts and Sidney Evans had both just turned 20 when the revival broke out, but they were used to reap a mighty harvest. They followed the same procedure as Evan. They sought the Lord daily for his will, and they went where he told them to go. They knew that apart from the presence and power of the Holy Spirit, they would accomplish nothing. When they arrived in a place, sometimes they preached, sometimes they did not. Sometimes they kept silent during the entire service, which often lasted for 4 or 5 hours. The World on Fire, Chapter 3. During the Welsh Revival, people came to the meetings for God, not for a superstar. They crowded chapels to overflowing, not even knowing whether an evangelist would be there or not. Sometimes Evan Roberts would enter a meeting, sit on the front seat, and say nothing for 3 hours. Then he would stand up, preach, and pray for some 10 or 15 minutes and sit down. Sometimes he might preach the whole time or pray the whole time. Sometimes he would sit silently through the entire meeting. Regardless of what Evan did, the people would carry on under the influence of the Holy Spirit. There were soloists, there were duos, and special singers during the revival, but they seldom announced where they were going to sing. Sometimes they went to a place expecting to sing, but the Spirit had other plans, and they would keep their peace, or they might just pray. Those who witnessed their ministry only had the witness that when they did sing, it was the Holy Spirit. This was a revival in which the Lord Jesus Christ Himself was the center and the main attraction. It was noised abroad that He was in the house. The young workers knew that the Holy Spirit came to testify of Jesus, and if an evangelist or the evangelistic party became the center of the attraction, then the Holy Spirit would depart. Evan Roberts knew that he was popular, and he dreaded publicity because he felt that it detracted from the one who was the true source of the revival. He dreaded newspaper reporters. He dreaded adulation. Many times he withdrew himself from the meetings when he felt that the people were coming to see and hear him instead of coming for the Lord. In meetings where he felt that he was the center of attraction, he pleaded with an agonized spirit that the people would look away to Christ and him alone, or else the Holy Spirit would withdraw himself from them. Though Evan Roberts became the most publicized preacher in the world at that time, he repeatedly refused interviews with reporters who came from every part of the globe. He refused to be photographed except by members of his own family. He knew this awakening was of God and not from himself, and that if people idolized him, the glory would be withdrawn. He did not even answer the multitude of requests that came from publishing houses around the world seeking to write his biography. He greatly feared that by doing this, he might rob the Lord of some of the glory that was due only to him. To speak or not to speak. Being led by the Spirit requires knowing when not to speak as much as when to speak. Evan Roberts was a wonderful demonstration of this sensitivity to the Lord. As stated, sometimes during a meeting, he would sit among the people without saying a word. Visitors from different parts of the world were astonished as they observed him letting the course of crowded gatherings be dictated entirely by the people's sensitivity to the Spirit as they sang or prayed or testified. F.B. Meyer, a mature and renowned Christian leader, upon watching him in the meetings, explained, "He will not go in front of the divine Spirit, but is willing to stand aside and remain in the background unless he is perfectly sure that the Spirit of God is moving him." Then he added, "It is a profound lesson for us all. The one who knows when not to speak will speak with more authority when he does speak." Christian leaders who came from the ends of the earth stood in awe and bowed in adoration to God as they witnessed the revival. General William Booth, Rodney Smith, F.B. Meyer, G. Campbell Morgan, and many other renowned men of God came to marvel at this great visitation. In most cases, they only prayed or said a few words. Sometimes they sat quietly in the meetings while young people and even children prayed, sang, and testified in the Spirit. The men of God who came all quickly recognized that this was not a revival that came through great preachers or great preaching. This was a supernatural work altogether apart from either. To their credit, most of these men quickly understood that their very personalities would actually hinder the meetings, and they yielded to the Holy Spirit. Great preaching is loved by all who love the Word of God, but these great preachers all knew that their great preaching had never produced the kind of presence of the Lord they encountered in Wales. The children enter the kingdom. Since the 1990s, there has been a great movement to equip and train the children and youth in the ways of the Lord and to help them become fruitful members of the body of Christ. This movement is of the Lord and it is significant, but the Welsh revival was quite different. In Wales, it was the children and youth who sought to equip their parents and train the adults in the ways of the Lord. The Lord said that we had to become like little children to enter the kingdom. They may have more to teach us than we have to teach them. Evan Roberts was only 26 years of age when the revival broke out. His sister Mary, who was such an important part of the work, was 16. Their brother Dan and Mary's future husband, Sidney Evans, were both about 20. The singing sisters, who were greatly used, were between the ages of 18 and 22. Thousands of young people were converted and immediately sent throughout the land, testifying to the glory of God. Little children had their own prayer meetings and witnessed boldly to even the most hardened of sinners. The chapels overflowed with the young. A new song. Spontaneous worship that gives birth to a new form of worship is usually found in true revivals. This was also true of the Welsh revival. This too probably could not have happened had there been just one strong worship leader in the meetings. There were worship leaders present, but they yielded, understanding that this revival was not for the purpose of birthing new superstars, but to glorify Jesus. This allowed the Holy Spirit to give birth to new songs and to a new form of worship that had not been previously known. Much of the contemporary style of worship that is now attributed to either the Pentecostal or charismatic movements actually had its origin in Wales. This revival was exploding in Wales at the same time as the Pentecostal outpouring was beginning on Azusa Street in Los Angeles. The leaders of these two revivals, Seymour and Bartleman in Los Angeles and Roberts in Wales, They wrote to each other during the revivals. There was also a great deal of other interchange between the revivals as people hungry for God rushed from one to the other seeking His presence. Naturally, they impacted one another. One of the great contributions of the Welsh Revival was the new spontaneous form of worship called singing in the Spirit that was to become a signature of the Holy Spirit's presence for decades to come. R.B. Jones, a leader in the revival, said the following concerning the music. "The fact is, unless heard, it is unimaginable, and when heard, indescribable. There was no hymn book. No one gave out a hymn. Just anyone would start the singing, and very rarely did it happen that the hymn started was out of harmony with the mood at the moment. Once started, as if moved by a simultaneous impulse, the hymn was caught up by the whole congregation, almost as if what was about to be sung had been announced, and all were responding to the baton of a visible human leader. I have seen nothing like it. You felt that the 1,000 or 1,500 persons before you had become merged into one myriad-headed but simple-souled personality. Such was the perfect blending of the mood and purpose that it bore eloquent testimony to a unity created only by the Spirit of God." Another witness testified, "The praying and singing were both wonderful. There was no need for an organ or a piano. The assembly was its own organ, as a 1,000 sorrowing or rejoicing hearts found expression in the psalmody of their native hills." The World on Fire, Chapter 4, The Power of Prayer. The Welsh Revival was initiated and carried by a devotion to prayer and intercession that also spread throughout the worldwide Christian community. Much of the fire that continues in some of the great prayer movements of today could likely trace their origin to a lingering spark from the Welsh Revival. The prayer and praise mingled together in most of those meetings. James E. Stewart wrote about them. Quote, "It was praying that rent the heavens, praying that received direct answers there and then. The spirit of intercession was so mightily poured out that the whole congregation would take part simultaneously for hours. Strangers were startled to hear the young and unlearned pray with such unction and intelligence as they were swept up to the throne of grace by the Spirit of God. Worship and adoration was unbounded. Praise began to mingle with the petitions as answered prayer was demonstrated before their very eyes. Often when unsaved loved ones were the focus of the intercession, they would be compelled to come to the very meeting and be saved." Unquote. This further fed both the worship and the intercession. When the believers understood that God really did hear their prayers, prayer quickly rose to the highest priority in their lives. As they prayed with more faith, they began to see quick answers to them. When they became increasingly specific in their requests, the answers became even more spectacular. They would pray for specific friends or family members in one meeting, and that person would be at the altar seeking salvation in the next one. This would fan the flames of intercession even more, and this unquestionably fanned the flames of the revival. Prayer meetings that had been drudgery before became the main attractions, even for entire cities. Meetings swelled until overflowing, both with people and with the anointing. Meetings that were expected to be regular services quickly became prayer meetings as it became the first nature of everyone to pray. Groups walking to work would start praying as soon as they would be joined by a swelling crowd who were drawn by the anointing. Spontaneous prayer meetings started in shops and homes, and there were even cases when factories shut down so that the workers could pray. At the peak of the revival, the whole town population gathered to march around their neighborhoods and claim them for Christ. On several occasions, the population of a town would march to a neighboring town to pray for it, and the revival would inevitably be ignited there. This revival was a witness that few things can so energize believers as when they discover the power of prayer. They saved souls. The main focus of prayer in this revival was always for the lost. There can be no revival without soul winning. And in saving lost souls, the Welsh revival must be considered one of the most intense and effective revivals of all time. This revival was not a program for using a few preachers or a campaign to get church members testifying to the saving grace of the Lord Jesus. No classes were given on how to reach the lost. It just seemed like every Christian in Wales erupted simultaneously with a burning agony for the lost. The joy of salvation simply could not be contained by the believers, as every coal mine, tram car, office, school, or shop became a pulpit for the gospel. Even more than the preaching, it was the witness of the common believers which led multiplied thousands to a saving faith in Jesus. There was no set pattern or strategy for the witnessing. It was simply born out of an overflowing joy and faith that could not be contained in those who knew the Savior. The presence of the Lord was so intense in Wales that those who had traveled from the ends of the earth to witness it said that just being in one of the revival meetings was worth the whole journey, even if Evan and Dan Roberts or Sidney Evans were not there. Methodists claimed that it was a revival of the Wesley meetings of a century before. The people of Wales lost a lot of sleep because they were afraid that if they left the services, they would miss something wonderful. Many times the meetings carried on until 2 and 3 o'clock in the morning and did not end until the people, sometimes including the entire population of a city or town, had marched through the streets singing the praises of the Lamb. It was simply impossible for an unbeliever to escape this overpowering witness or not to be drawn into it by the sheer love and zeal of the people. Just as it is easy to identify a man or a woman who is in love as their lover dominates their minds and conversation, Wales fell so in love with Jesus that adoration for him lifted his name above anything else that could have captured the people's attention. The knowledge of the Lord simply washed over Wales, just as the waters cover the sea. As Jesus was lifted up, all men came. They knew how to carry the ark. The Ark of the Covenant represented God's presence to the ancient nation of Israel. Many great lessons are in the Old Testament stories of the Ark concerning how we should and should not treat the presence of the Lord. When the Ark was treated as holy and was carried before them into battle, great and miraculous victories were won. When the Ark was not treated as holy, but was used as a good luck charm, they lost the ark and the battle, and it was captured by their enemies. One of the greatest reasons why the Welsh revival burned so brightly for so long was that the leaders knew how to carry the ark of God's presence. They knew how to remain open, submitted to the Lord's leading, and understood how not to offend the Spirit. Those who were used so mightily in this revival were loath to say anything that might draw attention to themselves and away from the Savior. As Psalm 25:14 states, "The secret of the Lord is for those who fear Him." And they wanted to be close enough to Him to know His deepest secrets, so they learned to respect Him properly. Combined with their great love for the Lord, they had a profound and holy fear of offending Him. They loved the ark of His presence and could not be content without having it with them, but they also reverenced it enough to learn how to handle it properly. In this great awakening, there was no ministry building, no boasting in men, but only in the Lord. When the glory of the Lord really does rest on an earthen vessel, it is not the vessel that receives the attention. We must heed Peter's warning. 1 Peter 5:6 says, "Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that He may exalt you at the proper time." It is our job to humble ourselves. It is God's job to exalt. If we try to do His job, He will do our job. Because the leaders of the Welsh revival were utterly committed to humbling themselves, God did exalt them. They refused to send out newsletters to build their own ministries, so the Lord used the front page of almost every major newspaper in the world to spread the word of what He was doing in Wales. As soon as He found the people humble enough to handle His promotion, He gave it to them. We can build influence by self-promotion, but God will promote only those who do not promote themselves. That which is built on self-promotion will have to be maintained by human striving. Those who allow God to build the house have taken a yoke that is easy and a burden that is light. Those who allow God to build the work will not be worn out by the work, but will be refreshed in it. No man can tear down that which God builds. When we do the work of God, we do not carry the worries and fears that those who have built on self-promotion must carry. Everything God does will remain forever, says Ecclesiastes 3:14. The fruit of the work that God initiates will remain. The work that is built on self-promotion inevitably ends in tragedy and disappointment. Though it is apparent that the high state of the Welsh revival itself did not last, some of the fruit of it did. It was able to impart to the universal church an understanding of the ways of God that are used by the church to this day. When revival itself becomes our goal, it is seldom attained because it becomes an idol. Revival must never become an end in itself, but a means to an even higher end, the glory of the Lord being revealed and His kingdom being extended. Sometimes His kingdom is extended by other means than revival. Certainly, we need more true revivals, but even those are founded upon simple obedience to whatever His plan may be, and His whole plan does not revolve just around revival. This day-to-day obedience of the church and growing in true spiritual maturity is just as important to the fulfillment of God's purposes as the great outbreaks of revival. When the cloud of His presence lifts and begins to move, we must be ready to move with Him. When the cloud does not move, it is just as important that we rest in Him.